Well, here we are again at Stuart Paquette's Farmall Museum, take two. It's November, no, I take that back, December of 2013. Thanksgiving is in the history books, and the ladies in my life are having a girl's day out, so I came down to Stu's to check out his tractor collection again. I was down here a couple years ago. Farmall Museum posted on YouTube, and I suspect that's where this will end up as well. This is the main show barn. I believe it's about 200 feet and what, 60 wide, give or take. And we have everything from lawn power products, as the sign says. Some of the smaller items that International Harvester made here in the background. Wood chipper, riding lawnmowers, push mowers, you name it. And we have stationary engines here, and home appliances over there in the corner. He's got a collection of, looks like 5-6 refrigerators, a couple of chest type freezers. And let's see, we'll just start down one side, I guess, and walk on down. Here's an Electrol, which generated power on the farm via the PTO on the tractor, kind of before electricity wandered out into the countryside very far. Here we have a 1950 Cub White demonstrator, a 48 Cub. As you can see, Stu has Stu's stuff painted on all the tractors here, so that's what the deal is there. Okay, here's a 46A, a 42AI, an industrial A is what the I stands for, distinguished by its boxed front axle as opposed to the round front axle that you can see on this one. And there's a couple of other small items too, such as a foot throttle on this one, but that's kind of the distinction. Very often they were painted yellow or whatever color. They went to municipalities, states, counties, whatever. Here's a 41B, which is pretty much an A with a narrow front end. Here's a BN, which has a narrower rear wheel track. And here's a 47BN tricycle. Here's a 1950 C demonstrator, a white demo. These tractors were painted white at the factory, sent to dealerships, and they went out to farms for demonstration purposes. And sometimes they got repainted back to red, and sometimes they didn't. Most of them, I think, were repainted red, but often the farmers got their hands on it. They wouldn't let them go. Here's a beautiful 49 C. A 53 Super C, wide front. A 40H, says Pinky's Toys, Derby, Vermont. So this must be another enthusiast that maybe has his tractor on loan down here for display purposes. Here's a 53 Super H. I think that was that the first year of the Super H? Not real sure. It was early 50s. Here's the 54 Super H, and that was definitely the last of the Super H's. The battery was moved from the center part of the tractor. You can see the battery box down here, if I can get in there far enough. Yeah, doesn't show up real well. And they were moved to under the seat. That box that you see the seat sitting on is where the battery was on the 54 model. Here's a 51M, a 53 Super M, again Pinky's Toys of Derby, Vermont. Hope I'm not messing up that name. The LP gas fans in the crowd, a 52 Super M LP gas model. And let's see, I don't know, maybe I'm walking the wrong way. Sometimes I am and sometimes I'm not. A 54 Super MTA. A 51 MD. The only bad thing about taking pictures in a museum is the lighting's never right and you can never get far enough away. Here's a 53 Super MD, a 54 Super MDTA. The torque amplifier is what the TA stands for. And that was the first year of the TA. I think it was on the M, and that was about it. Then 55 model year, the 100 series came out, and those, it was an option, but many of those tractors had the 300, the 400. Okay, here's a 1940 W4, which was kind of the McCormick standard tread version of the H, and the W6. And I don't see a year on this one, but that was the again the McCormick version of the M. Yeah, I don't see a year on that. Here's a, well, it says 44 W9. Yep, that's a beauty. That is a beauty. I believe that was like the biggest tractor of its day that IH made, or International Harvester Company, even though it says McCormick Deering on it. Here's an International Cub Lowboy. Says 55 on it, but I don't know if it had that paint scheme in 55. I stand corrected, it says 56 model. So I'm not sure when the new paint scheme came out. Here's a 55 Farmall Cub, and again I'm not sure about the paint scheme when they switch from the solid red to the two-tone. And here's a nice International 3300 Series B loader. Okay, down this side we've got a 56 300 LP gas, a 56 350, and again I'm not sure when they changed over. Some guys just repainted their tractors the new colors just so it fooled the neighbors into thinking that they had a new tractor on the farm. Here's a 56 350 Wheatland Special. Kind of a specialty tractor for the West Plains areas of the U.S. and Canada. Has the different fenders. And here's a 57 350 Utility, which is an orchard special. It has all the additional fairing on it for going under orchard trees, apple trees, what have you. A 56 W400 Diesel. That's a beauty. I may have to pause here and get a picture of that with my still camera, just in case I missed it. Excuse me. Okay, after the pause, we're back to the Diesel W400. Beautiful, beautiful tractor. And here's a 650 Diesel, and it's a 1956 model. Here's a 58 240 Utility. This tractor they made in a row crop version with the taller tires as well. And the same thing with this 1960 340 Utility. That was done in a row crop. In fact, they got a row crop version of it over in the other barn. The new barn that wasn't built last time we came through here. And here's a 59 650. One of Stu's pulling tractors. I see some trophies up there. I don't know where the pulling was at. They do a pull here every year. And 63 706 gas has the clamshell fenders as opposed to the big flat top fenders that you see. Mid 60s they changed over. I want to say 65 that they changed over. And here's a 66 806 LP gas. And here's an 64. Yeah, of 64 806 gas powered. And again, it has the clamshell fenders. So I want to say the 63 and the 64s, which were the first 2 years of production, had the clamshell fenders. And then the, I think it was 65, they started producing them with the flat top fenders, as you can see in this not so wonderful picture at all. The light again is in the wrong spot. Yeah, here you can better picture where the headlights were mounted in the fenders, as opposed to just mounted on the side. So they went to dual headlight configuration as well there. And here's a 65 504. This tractor was built in the row crop version, which is this with the taller tires, and it was made in a utility version as well. Here's a 63 404, International 404 utility. And yet again, they did many of the smaller tractors, they did a utility version and a row crop version. And here's a 424 diesel. That's a 1967 model. I would guess most of these were gas tractors, but the diesel's a bit of a rarity. And here is a 2444, which is the industrial version of the 444. Again, a utility tractor, 1968 model. And here's a 1970 544 Farmall. And the row crop version of this tractor in 1970, but it is not a gold demonstrator, although Stu does have a 1970 544 gold demonstrator. It's over in the other barn right now. And here's a little bit better shot of the 2444 industrial. And here is a 656 gas, a 1969 model, row crop version. So we've got the 69 656 gas version here. And in just a second, immediately to the right, we have 656 diesel. That's a 71 model. They made the 656 for quite a few years. Don't recall, I think the first ones were like, I want to say 67, 68. And they made them for quite a few years. American Road Equipment Company, Omaha, Nebraska. In memory of A.J. Paquette, which I'm guessing was probably Stu's dad, 1915 to 1975. So Stu's dad passed away in 75. Okay, let's do a little sweep around here and see if we can't get the center row of tractors. Here's a Super A with the one arm single arm loader on it. Here's a 39 AV, the V standing for vegetable. Has the Cultivision, and you can see it's got the kind of the extenders on the front wheels, and it's got the tall wheels in back, and you can see where it actually says Cultivision in letters right there. Here's a 47 AV. So again, this is a tractor that they made quite a few different years. A 48 AV, high clearance. And this is kind of high clearance row right here. I think all of Stu's high clearance tractors are here in the center row of this barn. He's got a gold demo over in the other barn. So here we have a 47 HV. And a 48 HV. And this is, well, let's look at this other one here and get a bit better look. They have the arch cast front axle on these HV models. And they did that for the first, I don't know how many years, of the high clearance models, the HV and the MV. And here we have a Super HV. Now they have the more conventional round tubular axle here with the tall spindles on each side and some additional bracing in the center section there. And this is again a 54 Super HV. And here is a 47 MV tricycle style, single front wheel. May well have been on a cotton picker. That was the type of tractor that they used on the cotton machines. One of which Stu has over in the other shed. Here's a 48 MV. And this sunshine coming in the other end is gonna mess things up for me, of course. Here's a 53 Super MV. All of Stu's tractors are very well done. They might not be exactly 100% correct, but they're beautiful. Here's an MDV, high clearance diesel. The D standing for diesel, of course. And what have we got here? Okay, this is a Hydro 86 1979 model. See if we can get a better angle on this, get more of it in. And a 1979 86 Hydro high clearance. They just started calling them high clearances. And this is a, well, as the Hydro stands for, the hydrostatic drive, which is one lever. You push forward, you go forward, and you pull back, and you go backwards. With a center slot to keep you from jamming from one direction to the other. Here's a nice 69 Farmall 140. It's an industrial, I believe, in addition to the yellow color. And again, it has this boxed front axle. I don't know how well that's coming up on the on video, but that's what it is as opposed to the round front axle. So we're kind of right back where we started. I guess we'll just take a cruise down through here and walk the couple hundred feet to the other end, and we'll go over to the new barn that was completed about a couple years ago, year and a half, 2 years, something like that. Or maybe I think we'll go over to the workshop next. See what's cooking over there. Stu has a couple of employees that are always working on restorations for him, and see what kind of surprises he has over there for us. So I will sign off for now, and I'll see you over in the restoration shop, which is on the back end of the dealer. Okay, yeah, there's the dealership over there by the distinctive international red pylon up in the front part, and attached to it in the back here is restorations. They do all the mechanical work here, but Stu has a painter that he drives the tractors down there, and he paints them, then he drives them home. So they do all the mechanical work here. That is the show barn over there, where is a whole collection of Lazy Boy recliners and tables. It's an event building is what it really is, and they have a large screen at one end, and it's pretty much I don't know, eight hours a day of International Harvester films and promotional films, anything that IH produce that it is anybody's been able to scrape together. And it has shows video of pulling events, tractor pulling events, that of course feature Farmall and International Harvester. Okay, here is a something else awaiting restoration. It's an R110 pickup. Looks like it's missing a few parts, although they may be around here someplace. And as I joked the last time, there actually are a couple of buffalo here at the Buffalo Ranch. You see one, looks like a little guy over there. Let's see if I can zoom in enough. Just to the right of those trees. Yeah, you can see him. Beautiful facility here, and boy, it's getting warm. We're talking, it's the 4th of December, and it's supposed to hit 80 today. Okay, here is a 1066 Hydro industrial model, and they're still working on it, of course, in the middle of painting, so presumably the mechanical work has been taken care of, the mechanics and electrical. They are doing some, I don't know if they just haven't assembled yet, or if they, I don't think they actually do any painting here, or at least that's the story I got. But here's the sheet metal that goes on the 1066 Hydro Industrial. And it looks like Stu has stumbled onto a, I'm guessing it's a 544. By the looks of the front axle, 544 utility, which is in the throes of restoration. Uh-oh. Stu stumbled onto several two-point hitch drawbars here. And you got some parts here. They don't sell parts here, but of course when you're working on tractors or any mechanical item, you end up collecting lots of spare parts. Now here's something kind of unique that Stu was telling me about this morning. They only sold these. It's the Johnny Reb Edition International Pickup Truck. And it comes with the fiberglass top and the graphics, and I'm guessing the wheels. They went to dealers. I don't know, I don't believe that they were sold to the general public, but it's a 1010 custom V8, or it says 8 there, so that's what they're working on now here. That's what they're working on right now. So I think maybe I'm going to take a little break, have a snack, maybe have a drink of caffeine, and then we'll head over across the street to the other barn. And I'm looking forward to seeing this, and I guess that'll have to wait until my next trip down here. That's going to be gorgeous, a real beast. 1066 Hydro Industrial. Okay, bye for now. Okay, here we are in the show barn. and it's probably the envy of mine and a lot of guys' idea of what their what a shop would be like. We have a nice collection of Lazy Boy recliners that Stu's put together. And you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 guys sitting there watching a movie. And let's see here. I don't know if it's showing up. You can see the big America flag, and there's a screen up there, but it's not not really showing up. It's showing the half century of progress tractor parade, which they have every other year up in, well, it's the old Chanute Air Force Base up in Illinois, Indiana. I'll say say Illinois, but I wouldn't. No, I'll say Indiana, but I wouldn't swear to it. There was stationed at Chanute. So, and there's a stage, and he fills this up with folding tables, and there's, of course, lots of memorabilia, lots of state flags run along the sides. I got a bar over there. Here's one of the tables. Some hunting trophies up there. Jay Stewart's classic cars. I don't know if he was ever into classic cars, maybe. So, and gasoline and Chevrolet and, you know, automobile. There's a big Pepsi bottle cap up there. Texaco sign, SO. Lots of Coca-Cola stuff. Anyhow, that's what's here in the show barn, their event barn. Their events barn. Beautiful old Coke machines here. Some of those collectors would love to get their hands on this stuff. Anybody that's interested in a very nicely restored Farmall Cub and a blade, no snow here, $7,250 or best offer. It's a 1953 Cub, beautifully restored, beautiful job. Okay, well, I had a lunch break and I think I'm going to head over to the new barn. Look at some more tractors. Okay, just kind of finished up my snack here, and we're looking at a 1566. Very much original. I'm assuming that it's a 1976, which was the last year for the 66 series. A 1566 BS, and the BS doesn't stand for Boy Scout, it stands for Black Stripe. They changed the graphic motif, if you will, and so they have the kind of a hockey stick that goes the length of the hood sheet metal and up over the top of the hood, and so they are fairly collectible. The Black Stripe series, which were 1976, and I think maybe some of the very late 75s got that as well, because this was the last model before the 86 series came out, and the 86 series were beginning to be produced in late 1976. I think August, September, right in there. I think the build on a friend of mine's Dirt Boys up in Pine Island, Minnesota. He has the first 1086 off the production line, and that was built in August of 1986. So I don't know if all the 86 series tractors, the different models, were started then, but that was the beginning of them. So anyhow, we're gonna pack up and cruise across the road over into the new building that Stu finished up here about a couple years ago now, and look at a whole bunch more tractors. So stay tuned. Okay, that is the dealership area. lots of memorabilia, t-shirts, hats, whatever for sale. And again, connected to the back is the workshop area where they do a lot of the mechanical restoration. At Stuart Paquette's Farmall Museum, and the show barn is back there behind that red tractor and these gentlemen. This is the main display barn, and it's a fairly lengthy building, as you can see. And a couple of years ago, Stu decided to expand his operation a little bit, and he's built this facility. You can see here they got barrels set up. They do some tractor pulling here. They have a couple of events that they have every year, and I guess be antique tractor pulling. I don't think they have any of the big high-powered, high-speed stuff here. Here's a link belt speeder, an LS-51, in memory of A.J. Paquette, 1915 to 1975. Stu's background is in construction. Had quite a big asphalt plant construction business up in New Hampshire. And I guess he sold out down there and came down here to retire, then started another business down here. And then he caught the Farmall bug, the red flu, if you will, and started buying and collecting, restoring, and one thing led to another. That's just kind of the way it works sometimes. And then he ended up with this pretty amazing facility here. This is the Hall of Fame, he calls it. And it's has a flatbed truck here that he's working on, and he's got some stuff waiting restoration or cleanup. In the back you can see tractors and various pieces of equipment back there. I really like this 4366. It doesn't have a glossy shiny coat on it. It looks like maybe they've, maybe done the mechanical work and they shot some primer on it, maybe, I don't know. Or if it's just original. I wouldn't have thought that was the original. Well, if it was the original paint, it's just, you know, dulled and oxidized over the years, but looks like she's all there, which is on display in front of the International Hall of Fame building here at the Farmall Museum in Leesburg, Florida. Any IH or general tractor fans want something to do, a great way to spend the afternoon while they're down in Florida. Apparently this is their busy season. They said all the snowbirds come down for the winter, so they get a whole lot more business here at the museum than they typically do during the summer. And just to show you, it's 80 degrees here right now on the 4th of December, and can't imagine what it must be. It must be god-awful hot and humid in the summertime down here. So anyhow, let's go in and have a look. And here we have a 1975 4166, one of the earlier four-wheel drive tractors. It's not articulated. Stu picked this up. A gentleman in Iowa restored this for him 2 years ago. He brought it to the show in Minnesota, Albert Lea, Minnesota, and that's where Stu took ownership, I guess, and then they shipped it down here. Beautiful, beautiful shape. And let's see, yeah, 75 International 4166, 2,565 manufactured. This tractor was located in south of Williams, Iowa, and it had been setting for about 10 years. But it looked pretty good, so it was transported to Radcliffe, Iowa, to Denny Neubauer's farm, and Denny restored it. And I guess sold it to Stu then. Beautiful tractor, beautiful tractor. And over here we have an IH3588, which is an articulated row crop tractor. Pivots in the middle. It's a 1981 model. I think 79 was the first year for these. So, and that's a beauty. Original tires, presumably. Covered wagon. I don't know that would be built by IH or not. And here we have the gold row. Stu's collection of 1970 demonstrators. Again, this was these tractors were painted gold at the factory and sent to dealerships in a fairly haphazard manner, from what I understand. I guess you never knew what you were going to get. Went out to farms to demonstrate the performance of these tractors and trying to sell them, and very often they went back to the dealership and repainted red. But once in a while, some farmer refused to let go of it, and he just wanted to hang on to it, so it just stayed at the farm and it stayed gold. So here we have a 1026 Wheatland, again a 1970, these are all 70s, a 1026 Wheatland Rice Special. This is a one of one. All the 1026s were hydro models, but it's a gorgeous, gorgeous tractor. You can see the rice style tires on it. Very deep pleated tires. And here's another one of one, a 1026 hydro gold demonstrator high clearance. And this was again one of one. I don't know if I can get a bit of a picture of what this looked like when Stu got it. So, one of, and here is an 826 gold demo, much more common. Quite a few of these tractors around. These came in gear drive or hydrostatic, which is was an option, and this is the gear drive model. So, and right next to it is the 544 hydro, and this as well could be had in a hydro or gear drive. And they also made a gold demo utility version of this tractor. So Stu bought this from a Red Power Forum gentleman up in North Carolina and brought it down here and had it gone through, of course. And here's a 656 gold demo, a hydro utility. And they made this in a, well, it says row crop. It's kind of a, basically it's a 656 utility high clearance. But they also did a regular utility version of the 656 gold demo. Like I say, it was just kind of haphazard. They just kind of painted tractors coming down the line. So, like Forrest Gump said, you like a box of chocolates, you don't know what you're going to get. And here's Stu's pickup. It's a 1953 model. If we can get around, get a better angle on this, see what it is. That's a R120. Here's a 61. 110. This is a fairly recent addition to Stu's collection. Here's a 1980. I believe this was the last year of the International Scout, and it is diesel powered. I was told it's powered by a Nissan diesel, so just not real sure on this. So here's a 1964 220, beautiful tractor. And here's a 59 190. And here's the back end for anybody that's interested. maybe a bit better angle on some of these trucks. When we came in, we passed a semi-trailer with all kinds of design graphics, advertising on the side of it. And I think Stu uses the 220 to pull it with. And here we have a 1970 Scout 800A. It's originally a Kingman, Arizona. Tony Torti was the owner. It's got the 345 fuel injection, Bergwerner 3-speed automatic, Scout 2 front and rear axles, power disc brakes, power steering. Lots of goodies. Vintage air conditioning and heat. So this calls it Scout Desert Gold. So if this is a 1970, this may well have been the original paint color for the Scouts. There's a bit of debate about that. Again, a gentleman in North Carolina is convinced, and rightly so, that they just took a IH truck / Scout 1970 model year paint and used that. Paint the gold demos. Lost my thread there, as my English wife tells me. So that gold there would have been the same gold that they used on the tractors over here. Okay, let's get back on track. Here we have a 1973 666 Hydro, which was pretty much just the next rendition of the 656 Hydro, and then it became the 686, and someplace along the line it became a Hydro 70, and it was all basically the same tractor, maybe tweak here and there for horsepower. Nice medium size, good all-round tractor. Here's a nice 1486. This is a 78 model. 1486, big tractor, lots of power. Had to have a fair amount of farm to justify that. Here's a 1972 1468, in the early 70s, the tractor industry kind of caught the V8 power rage, if you will, and so of course International Harvester had to jump on the bandwagon. What they did is they took a International Harvester truck engine and did some tweaking and modifying to it to make a 1468. Quite collectible now, a real novelty, a great parade tractor. Understand it wasn't a real big hit on the farm because it didn't produce any more oomph than the straight six did. And so everybody, most of the people opted for the straight six. Here's the 1970, which the year on the 76 it says, 1568. Makes me wonder why, if it's really a 76, why isn't it a black stripe? But who knows, like I say, people took, farmers and restorers kind of take artistic license with the tractors. Here's a beautiful Farmall 1206. This is a 67 model, so I believe this would have been the last year they only made them. I think 3 years, 65, 66, and 67. First International Harvester product to crack the 100 horsepower mark. And boy, I don't know where Stu got all these weights, but all these things are loaded with weights. And here's a gorgeous, a 1965 806 diesel Wheatland. The big fat rubber around really makes it look bad. The big full coverage helmet, or helmets. You can tell I'm a motorcycle guy. Full coverage fenders on this. Love those big meats on the front, and as well as on the back. Yeah, that's a gorgeous tractor. That is a gorgeous tractor. So the last time I was here, Stu had quite a few of these tractors over in the other barn and lined the center of his where he has high clearance tractors now. And he didn't have a 1206 at all. Okay, here is not one of Stu's vehicles. It's a 100 automatic, and it is a 1974 International 100 automatic half-ton pickup with a 345 cubic inch V8 two-barrel carburetor and a 727 Chrysler automatic, which was a pretty industrial strength automatic transmission. Beautiful shape, beautiful condition. And right next to it here is a really nice little 340 row crop. We saw the 340 utility over in the other barn, and again, this is not one of Stu's tractors, it's just somebody just kind of left it here for display. Can't get much of an angle on this with the pickup there. And here we have a one bottom plow, a three bottom plow, a couple of 1 point one bottom plows, maybe for a cub or an A, and a couple of two bottom plows. He has a ton of equipment in this facility here. Okay, let's back up, see if we can get a full range shot on this here. It's a 314 cotton picker with an M, and I seriously doubt if it was originally painted white, but you can see the exhaust system laying down on top across the hood, and all the apparatus to be able to feed the steering and the controls up to the driving position on this cotton picker. Quite a monstrosity, if you will. This is a southern tractor, of course, where cotton was king. Never saw one of these until I saw this one, other than pictures. Up in Michigan, central Michigan, we were corn and beans. Soybeans, navy beans. Here we have a really nice 1953 Super MD. D standing for diesel, of course. And here are some tractors I suspect are on the waiting list. A Farmall 400 tricycle. LPG. And here's an original Farmall 706 LP gas. I'm guessing it's an early model because it's got the clamshell fenders, so it's probably a 63 or 64. And here's a Farmall M. Looks like the tractor has been restored and the picker hasn't. Oh, here's a 1440 International Axial Flow Combine. So Stu's getting quite a diverse collection here. Here's a 52 Super C with cultivators. That was a long, slow, painful process sitting on one of those cultivating. Well, looks like Stu managed to pick up a 1206 Wheatland. Or 1206 Standard. There is a distinction, but it escapes me right now. And I don't know, I'm guessing this thing came with fenders. Or maybe he needs to find some fenders and a seat and whatever. She's needing some TLC, right? That's for sure. And here's a nice Farmall H. Looks like it's already been gone through. Looks like new tires and really a really a nice rig. And here's a 300 utility with TA. You can see the TA lever right here on the left side. And the torque amplifier plaque there. And you started getting a jam and your engine was lugging down and you were running out of juice. You just grabbed a hold of that and pulled it back and it downshifted for you. So it doubled your transmission speeds. I think this is probably a 5-speed transmission. And the torque amplifier gave you a 10-speed transmission because you could use the TA in any gear. And many a time on an old Farmall 300, I grabbed the TA to get me out of a jam in kind of some of the sandier areas that we had up in central Michigan. Here's a kind of a forlorn looking A, an M with a corn picker, and both needing some TLC. And here's what I'm guessing is a W4. Nice looking little guy. Tires are getting a little low. He needs some... Oh, wait a minute. Is that a W or an I? Oh, that's... Yeah, I think it's a W. A W4. Paint's in pretty rough shape. It's hard to tell. And here we have a 2A hay conditioner and a 51 Farmall Cub, a 60-inch Woods mower, model 59. Runs great. Good turf tires. Needs nothing. $3,750. $3,750. Or with paint and new seat, $5,000. So if you had a few acres to mow, that would be your answer to it. Even with a paint job and a new seat, it's a whole heck of a lot cheaper than some of the new yard tractors, town and country tractors that you run into. Oh, here's a nice terracer that looks like it's been restored. Oh, Clemenson Farms, Pine Island, Minnesota. Oh, this thing's a long ways away from home too. And what do we have here? Some spare doors and some grill parts for, I'm thinking maybe Scouts and glass. Stu's getting quite a collection of spare parts here. Well, here's a McCormick 100 spreader that apparently has already been gone through, and a nice hay rake. Don't see a number designation on it. And here's a C, Farmall C, wide front. I don't know how the innards are on it, but it looks from the outside about all it needs is a is paint. Fenders are there, seat, well, you know, everything's there. Nothing looks to be bent up or bashed, so. And here is a model 37 International baler that looks like it's been restored and not used since. Here's a number 46 white demo. So this would have been built to go with the 1950 white demo letter series tractors, the Cub, the Super A, and the C were the three tractors that were in the white demo program. So if you see an H or an M that's painted white and made to look like a demonstrator, it's a fake. But again, people like to take a little artistic license with their equipment sometimes. Every once in a while you'll stumble, it's like the Super HTA. Other than for experimental purposes, they never made a Farmall Super H with a factory TA. It was not a production tractor. Okay, let's see here. We've got a McCormick Reaper. I'm guessing it cuts and shocks wheat. It's definitely before my time, so I'm in a bit of a loss here, folks. I'm sorry. And of course, the threshing machine. I think Case, J.I. Case, was the big dog in the McCormick, or in the threshing machine business. But other companies did make them. Here's a Farmall F12. Don't see a year on it. And here's another little tidbit. You see the steering shaft is up at an angle. Well, originally the F12 had, that shaft was flat. The shaft holding up the steering shaft was a bit shorter, and it was straight across the hood. Well, lots of guys retrofitted it because the F12 became the F14, and don't ask me what year. They only made the F14 for a couple of years, but lots of guys saw, oh, that's really nice, I really like that. Makes the steering wheel at a much more comfortable angle, so they went back and retrofitted their F12s with the kind of the angled steering shaft. So that's how that came about. International 500 asked for demo. Early riser planters. So I guess it was some kind of dealer piece of equipment that would demonstrate their planters. Here's a 39 F20. Another little bit of Farmall IH trivia. The F-series tractors were all painted gray, kind of a gunmetal gray, up until the latter part, I think it was 1937, when they started painting them red. So again, but you'll see lots of tractors that were F models that were built before 1937, they'll paint them red, just because everybody likes to have a red tractor, but that's the story behind that. Again, kind of a retrofit. And here was the big dog, the F30. Bigger, more power, longer frame, a bigger, more powerful tractor than the F20. So in the F-series, you had the F12, the F14, the F20, and the F30. This one's quite a nice one. Okay, and speak of the devil, here is an F14. And as you may or may not be able to tell, it's very, very similar to the F12, except for the steering shaft. And I'm sure they probably maybe tweaked another horsepower or two out of it. They probably reset the governor to turn a couple hundred more RPM to get a little more power out of it. But that was the story on that. Oh, and what do we have here? Zip-tied. Somebody's idea of a joke. 50 milligrams of Viagra. And that probably requires no further comment. Yeah, every time you come down to Stu's, he's got a little bit more to show you. Oh, almost forgot. A number 230 wind rower here. And looks like it's in quite decent original condition. I think these hail from the mid-60s. I could be wrong. Could be later than that. Oh, and here's a International Harvester freezer, or that could be a milk cooler. A cooler that was in milk houses to keep the cans of milk cold. You'd milk it either into the milking machine or straight into a pail, and you'd go from the pail slash milking machine into a milk can, which was about 24, 25 inches high, something like that, not real tall. They'd fill them with milk, and then they would put those in there to keep them cool. Until the milkman came around and picked up the milk. back before everything went bulk, probably back in the late 60s, early 70s, I think that that transition started taking place. So then you didn't have any cans to wrestle around. All you did is you drove your truck up to the milk house, and then you shot a hose through a special opening that most farmers built into the side of the milk house wall, and you hooked it up to the bulk tank, and you flipped a lever and you turned the pump motor on, and it sucked it right out and into the truck, and off you went. So the toughest part of hauling milk from then on was the power steering in your truck. But no more hoiking the cans. And those, very often, those coolers were filled with water that was kept cold to keep the milk cans cold. And so you would end up drenched from the belt down. Lots of milk haulers wore a leather apron, but they were kind of awkward and cumbersome. So some guys used them and some guys didn't. And I guess in the summertime when it was warm and sunny and your pants would dry fairly quickly, and you didn't have to worry about catching pneumonia so much, it wouldn't be bad. But boy, in those cold Michigan winters, this is a really nice H. Really nice. Really like that. Well, I'm just kind of wandering now and probably repeating myself. Oh, I don't know if I showed you this 915. Oh, it's a hydrostatic corn and bean special. International Combine, hydrostatic drive. Quite nice original condition. I don't know what Stu's going to do with these, if he's just going to keep them as is, or he's going to attempt some kind of restoration on them. Boy, that would be a pretty massive job. Just the painting alone would be pretty horrendous. Here's the rear teeth, the rear gangs on the cultivator on the Super C. Yeah, here's a back view. Some of these tractors have the ropes, rollover protection system, which was an option, and I think they become mandatory at some point, but added a little safety and a little bit of comfort for the farmer, kept a little bit of the sun off on him before cabs became pretty much the norm in the 80s. Boy, I just love that big old fat 806. Yeah, that is sweet. That is really nice. As are most of Stu's toys, Stu's stuff, as he paints on the side, as he probably got it. Yeah, you can see it. Well, let me show you on a red tractor. Makes it pop out, the white lettering comes out on Stu's stuff. Stu doesn't seem to have any of the 88 series tractors. Maybe he'll stumble onto something. So many of those are still in use. It's amazing. Okay, just talking to some folks from Iowa, and they said a place, Griswold, Iowa, little town of Griswold, which is not very far from Avoca, Iowa. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right at all, but apparently they have 5 different museums. I guess they're tractor and car related museums in Griswold, Iowa. So maybe I'll have to check that out. So I don't know. Get things straightened up here. I've taken pictures of just about everything there is to take and video of everything, so I don't know how much longer I'm going to be hanging around. Love this place. Really like that new Scout 1980 with a Nissan diesel engine. That's amazing. That is amazing. As far as these gold demos are concerned, it seems like they made quite a few 826s, which is this one. And they made lots of 1456s, which is that big Hummer down here on the end. But not nearly as many of the other models. Like I say, this 1026 Riceland Special and the 1026 High Clear, those are each one ofs. Quite a few 826s. You don't run into that many 544s. And I think there's only a couple of 656s that are known to exist, although I'm sure out in barns and fence rows someplace there's more to be found. Anyhow, I'm gonna wander back across the road and we'll see how it goes from there. Well, I've been here too long. I'm not sure what I've taken pictures of and what I haven't. But when everything is digital, it's not a major concern. Not a major concern. Just keep on taping. And again, that's old school taping. This is digital. Video camera's got a 40 gig hard drive in it. So I don't even have to change anything, SD cards or anything. The only thing I have to do is change the batteries once in a while.